I want to thank Colin and all my friends for this opportunity. I can't really give much of an introduction, but some of you will have downloaded the booklet. That's been a project of mine for a long time, to encourage Christians really to celebrate the Passover. And this, without any question, the focus of this Haggadah, that's the booklet that is prepared and used by Orthodox Jewish people as they meet around a table, which many of them would have done last night. But in this particular Haggadah, the focus most certainly is Jesus. And there are two reasons for that, which I just want to briefly say. The first is that Passover is a feast of the Lord, as it says in Leviticus chapter 23. The Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the Israelites and say to them, these are my appointed feasts, the appointed feasts of the Lord, which you are to proclaim as sacred assemblies." And the fact is simply this: Jesus is Lord. And of course we know that because of many things, our own experience even, but not least because of what the Apostle Paul says in his letter to the Philippians, that Jesus Christ is Lord, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess, and we're happy to do so, that Jesus Christ is Lord. And Passover is a feast of the Lord. So what could we say? The Passover is a feast of Jesus. And therefore it's not really surprising that every element of the Seder speaks of him. There's another reason why this Haggadah is a little bit different to a traditional one, and that reason is prophetic. This is what the prophet Jeremiah says: "However, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when men will no longer say, as surely as the Lord lives, who brought the Israelites up out of Egypt," which you would have heard a lot of last night, "but they will say, as surely as the Lord lives, who brought the Israelites up out of the land of the north and out of all the countries where he had banished them, for I will restore them to the land I gave their forefathers." We're taking that into account. Why? Because we're living in those very days that Jeremiah prophesied about. So we begin with an invitation. Now, this Haggadah and this celebration of the Passover reflects my personality and my age. I will be 77 next birthday. So I'm bringing to you many of the songs that I love. And this first one is one of my very favourites, written by Graham Kendrick. But I want you just to look at the background on the screen, because I've used the images of this incredible piece of work, which is called the Fountain of Tears, which is both opposite me, living in Arad, across the street, in other words, but also now, some 500 metres from the gates of Auschwitz. Amazing story. Haven't got time to talk about it.
Come and see, come and see the King of Love. See the purple robe and crown of thorns he wears. Soldiers mock, rulers sneer, as he lifts the cruel cross. Lone and friendless now he climbs towards the hill. And we worship at your feet, where wrath and mercy meet. And the guilty world is washed by love's pure stream. For us he was made sin, oh help me take it in. deep wounds of love cry out, Father, forgive. I worship, I worship the Lamb.
Come and mourn
for your sin that pierced him there, so much deeper than the wounds of thorn and nail. All our pride, all our grief,
all our
fallenness and shame, and the Lord has laid the punishment on him. And we worship at your feet, where wrath and mercy meet, and a guilty world is washed by love's pure stream. For us he was made sin, oh help me take it in. Deep wounds of love cry out, Father, forgive. I worship the Lamb who was slain. Man of heaven,
born to earth,
to restore us to your heaven. Here we bow in all beneath your searching eyes. From your tears comes our joy.
From your death our life shall spring.
By your resurrection power we shall rise. And we worship at your feet, where wrath and mercy meet, and a guilty world is washed by love's pure stream. Father, forgive. I worship the Lamb who was slain.
Wonderful. Well, following the little booklet, for some will be using it, we've now arrived at page 4, and we have some reading. So I'll read the first one. Again, this is from Leviticus chapter 23. I could say these are Jesus' appointed feasts. Okay, they're the feasts of the Lord, the sacred assemblies you are to proclaim at the appointed times. The Lord's Passover begins at twilight on the 14th day of the first month. That was last night, folks. So, what can we conclude? On the 15th day of that month, okay, that's today, actually, the Lord's Feast of Unleavened Bread begins. For 7 days, you must eat bread made without yeast. That's the restriction. On the first day, hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. That's today. It's a Shabbat. It's a Sabbath day. For 7 days, present an offering made to the Lord by fire. And on the seventh day, hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. And Colin's going to read to us.
The Lord said to Moses and to Aaron in Egypt, "This month is to be for you the first month of the year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. The animals you choose must be year-old males without defect, and you may take them from the sheep or the goats. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month, when all the people of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and the tops of the door frames of the houses where they eat the lambs. That same night they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire, along with bitter herbs and bread made without yeast. On that same night I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. This is a day you are to commemorate. For generations to come, you shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance."
So we need to be prepared for Passover. We should remind ourselves of what the Apostle Paul says. We read it a lot, don't we? Every so often when we take communion. But I suppose the fundamental meaning is this one, for this feast, which we are to celebrate. And it says, he says, "Therefore, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup." So, how do we go about it, getting ready to celebrate this festival? Well, we need to prepare the home. Jeremy's going to read.
"For 7 days, no yeast is to be found in your houses. And whoever eats anything with yeast in it must be cut off from the community of Israel, whether he is an alien or native born."
Just to let you know that the Orthodox Jewish people really take this word seriously. What on earth is this Orthodox Jew actually doing? He's making sure that for 7 days no yeast is to be found in his house. So you can see this. We've seen it with our own eyes, even from our own house, in an empty plot next door to us. Orthodox Jewish people burning chametz, which is yeast. Anything with yeast. So I think he's throwing onto the fire a bag full of bread, probably. But there's something else that I want to bring to your attention. And it's this: on the first day of the unleavened, this is what it says in Mark's Gospel, chapter 14, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a pot of water will meet you. He will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make preparation for us there." Now, one of the questions that is often asked, how can Jesus meet with his disciples for the Last Supper, and that be Passover, and yet he's still going to die at the right moment according to the official calendar. I think the answer to the mystery is found in these words that we often don't even consider. Go into the city, and a man carrying a pot of water. What does that tell you? Well, we haven't got time to talk about it now, but maybe the next time I have this opportunity to give the talk in Daniel, I might refer to this point, because a man carrying a pot of water is part of a particular group of Jewish people. We can talk about it again. But much more important to that than that, the preparation of the home is the preparation of the heart. And now Jeremy's going to read.
Rid of the old yeast, that you may be a new batch without yeast, as you really are. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us keep the festival, not with the old yeast, the yeast of malice and wickedness, but with bread without yeast, the bread of sincerity and truth.
So the Apostle Paul is telling us that this idea of getting rid of yeast has a spiritual application in our lives. And what are we going to do? How are we going to get our hearts right? Well, we could ask this song as a prayer of the Lord. Purify my heart.
Purify my heart. Let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart. Let me be as gold.
Well, at this point, in a traditional Seder, candles would be lit. We're going to do it virtually, but we need to remind ourselves. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And typically, the candles are lit, and the blessing is said, by a woman of the household. For us today, I think it's Susanna.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has encouraged us to kindle festival lights, and who has given us Jesus, the light of the world. Amen.
Amen. Jeremy's going to read to us.
This is the message. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him, yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness.
If we confess our sins, it's an opportunity. This could be, in fact, our prayer of confession as we sing a song that I hope most of us know, Only by Grace. Been in a Jewish home, whether that Orthodox or Messianic, you probably would have seen a Seder plate on the table with lots of different items, and we'll look at some of those items. Obviously, most of us, I think, have just brought one or two items with us this morning, this afternoon now even, to participate in with this Seder. I suppose the most significant is a shank bone of a lamb. will be on a seder plate on every table. What does it represent? Well, the shank bone represents the lamb, of course, that was sacrificed. What can we say about it? Well, we read, Colin read to us, what happens on the 10th of Nisan, the first month. The lamb is taken into the house. Because it says this in Exodus chapter 12, on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb. What can we say? I believe this to be absolutely true. Jesus rides into Jerusalem on the 10th day of Nisan. We celebrate it as Palm Sunday. Whether it was a Sunday, well, we could argue that point. But it's definitely the 10th day of Nisan. It has to be, and it is. It's in fulfillment to the prophecy of Zechariah. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey. And what happens when the lamb is taken into the house on the 10th day? Well, it's examined. Has to be without defect. It's a fact. It says this in Exodus chapter 12, the animals you choose must be year-old males without defect. What can we say? Jesus was examined by all the leadership, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, the Herodians, even Pilate. And he says, I find no basis for a charge against this man. He's innocent, he's perfect, the perfect Lamb of God. And on the 14th of Nisan, the lamb is sacrificed at twilight. That's towards the end of that day. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month, when all the people of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Jesus dies, according to the official calendar, at twilight on the 14th day of Nisan. John spells it out for us in his gospel. It's a little bit different from the synoptics, because this is what it says in John chapter 19, verse 31. It was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. What day was it? It was the 15th of Nisan. That was to be a special Sabbath day. And amazingly, it says this in Exodus chapter 12, do not break any of the bones. Why? Why is that? Because it's speaking and pointing towards Jesus. Because his bones were not broken. Again, John's gospel. Because the Jews did not want the bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. What else would we have on a Seder table? Well, there'd be things like this. We'll look at them in more detail, but perhaps most particularly in... maybe some of us have brought unleavened bread. Could be matzah, as long as it's not got yeast in it. But matzah's really interesting because you've probably seen it, you probably have it, you probably eat it regularly. It's striped and pierced, certainly without yeast. The way it's made has to be completely without yeast. Unleavened bread, that's what we should use in communion, folks, but I won't get into that one. Interestingly, there are three loaves. They're in a container which is called a matzah tash. Three levels, quite often. But it's three. This is traditional. Interestingly, some people think that in the three matzahs you see God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And that in itself is fascinating, because the first one to be broken is the second matzah. Not the first, not the third, but the second. And half of it is hidden away, and we will look into that a little bit. But when we think of the matzah, we can certainly consider this verse in Isaiah: "But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds," in some versions, "by his stripes, we are healed." But then also on the table we will see a variety of different things. But there has to be bitter herbs. Remember that, what it said in Exodus and in Leviticus? Well, we can remember this verse at the beginning of Exodus. "They made out their lives bitter with hard labour in brick and mortar and with all kinds of work in the fields. And in all their hard labour, the Egyptians used them ruthlessly." And this is what the bitter herbs are to remind Jewish people of. And it could be horseradish. You see a whole horseradish root and chopped up or ground up horseradish. It's got to bring tears to your eyes. It's got to be hot. Then you've got lettuce or endive lettuce. And then a bowl of mixture, which is called charoset or haraset, which is to remind the Orthodox Jewish people, the Jewish people, of the clay that was used in making the bricks. It's to remind them of the hardship. There's also parsley. That's a very interesting element to have on a Passover table. What does it represent? Well, it represents hyssop, the hyssop plant. That's very significant. There are four cups. Well, maybe one cup. I've got one cup here, but I would drink from it four times. Why would I do that during the Seder? Well, it's based on these two verses, again in Exodus. "Say to the Israelites," this is God's initiative. He's going to do various things. He is going to say, "I will. I am the Lord, and I will bring you out." "I will bring you out" represents the first cup, from under the yoke of the Egyptians. "I will free you from being slaves to them." It's the second cup. Cup of freedom, or the cup of deliverance. The third cup, very interesting. "I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment." The fourth cup, "I will take you as my own people and I will be your God." Well, we got the chance now. If we have the element, we could put some wine or grape juice in the first cup. What are we going to call it? Well, it's got different names in different seders, different interpretations. I quite like the cup of sanctification, because we've spent time getting ourselves ready to take and to participate in this seder. So if you want, if you have it, you can add some grape juice or wine to the cup that you have. We're not going to drink from it just yet. Just to remind us, this is based on the verse in Exodus chapter 6, verse 6, "I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians." It's very interesting when you read the different accounts of the Last Supper in the Synoptic Gospels particularly. And Luke is interesting because he mentions two cups. We focus on one, which we will come to, the cup after supper, but there's one at the beginning too. How many cups did they drink from? I don't know. But in Luke's Gospel, we know at least twice, at least twice. "After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, 'Take this and divide it among you.'" What does it mean? It's very interesting. And then, of course, we can lift the cup. Let me do it. Let me get my cup. I will lift it. "Is not the cup of thanksgiving, for which we give thanks, a participation in the blood of Christ?" And then, of course, every time we drink from a cup in the Seder, we will say a blessing, and here's one. "Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen us and sanctified us with his commandments and with love, has given us solemn days for joy, for festivals and seasons of gladness. And this day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which starts today, the season of our freedom, a memorial to the Exodus out of Egypt, and we add, of course, and in remembrance that Jesus died for us and that his blood was shed for our sakes. And this is the special blessing that would be said prior to eating and drinking, particularly drinking in this instance, which in Hebrew is, and you can see it transliterated, Baruch atah, blessed are you, Adonai Eloheinu, Melech Ha'olam, Borei Pri HaGefen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. And we would drink from this first cup, and we have to recline. Traditionally, we have to recline, I think, to the left, because we're behaving like free men. And it reminds us that when the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. And we can drink from this cup. What's next in a traditional Seder is the washing of hands. And this is done because of the fact that following this drinking of the first cup, we're going to be handling some of the elements that we're going to eat at different times. It's called Erkatz washing. And the host, particularly the host, would stand aside from the Seder table and wash his hands and dry them on a towel. Actually, most often in an Orthodox home, that would happen twice during the Seder. But it reminds us of what is ahead of us, particularly for those of us, particularly me, who lives in the land in Israel. The Lord has made promises to this people, which includes sprinkling clean water. I will sprinkle clean water on you and you will be clean. Don't we need it? We do need it. I will cleanse you from all of your impurities and from all your idols. This nation needs it, folks. I think it's Roger who's going to read to us.
Reading from John 13. He got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began washing his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus replied, You do not realize now what I'm doing, but later you will understand. No, said Peter, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered, Unless I wash you, you have no part in me. Then, Lord, Simon replied, not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well. Now that I, the Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master. Nor is the messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be pleased if you do, or blessed if you do them.
The next part of the traditional Seder is called Karpas, which represents the opportunity to use the parsley. What does it represent? I've mentioned it already, I think. Because it says in Exodus chapter 12, verse 22, take a bunch of hyssop and dip it into the blood in the basin and put some of the blood on the top and on both sides of the doorframe. Roger's going to continue to read.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, only you, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow.
Isn't this amazing? In John's Gospel, later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty. The image, by the way, at the background is Rick's fifth panel of the Fountain of Tears, which is I thirst. A jar of wine vinegar was there. So they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on the stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. The raising of the hyssop in Egypt prefigured what would happen the day Jesus, Yeshua, shed his blood for us. The hyssop is there too. And so in a traditional Seder, that parsley would be taken by every participant and would be dipped into salt water, representing the blood of the lamb, and would be eaten. Of course, there has to be a blessing, and the blessing is this: Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Borei Pri, not HaGefen, which is the vine, HaAdama. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the ground. Everybody would eat that little bit of parsley. And now we come to the matzah, and we are going to break the middle matzah, the second matzah. Well, I've got three here. And I will take one. If you have three, you could try and break it. It's a bit difficult, but try and break it in the middle, like I've done here. This is really an interesting thing. And Roger's going to read to us again, because this is what is said about this bread.
Lo, this is the bread of affliction which our ancestors ate in the land of Egypt. Let anyone who is hungry come in and eat. Let anyone who is needy come and celebrate the Passover. This year we are here. Next year we hope to celebrate it in the land of Israel. This year we are servants here, but next year we hope to be freemen in the land of Israel.
So this is probably taken from a Haggadah, that is for the diaspora, for the Jewish people. Actually, I need to just highlight this, and I took the liberty to do this, I hope you don't mind. This, what Roger's read to us, is adapted from a Haggadah, a telling, an order of service, so to speak, for German and Polish Jews. It was published in 1849. Just inside the cover of a Haggadah that was handed to me as a keepsake from my Jewish family. This is service for the first two nights of Passover. That happens in the diaspora for German and Polish Jews. Published in 1849, if you look at the bottom. This is handwriting of my grandmother when she was a teenager. Do you want to see a picture of her? I've put it in. This is my grandma, my dad's mum. And this was her Haggadah. I don't know how old she is here. This is the earliest photo of her. She was actually born in 1869. She married in 1889 when she was 20. So she became Sarah Barnard in 1889. My dad was born in 1891. Yeah, that's an interesting story in itself. And this is her Haggadah. Now, just to point out the relevant page, this is what Roger read to us just a moment ago. So just to show you that it's taken from this Haggadah, and just to point out that we're going to move very quickly to ask the question, why is this night different from all other nights? So we're trying to follow the program that is recorded in the traditional Orthodox Haggadah. But before we do that, we need to recognize that we have two halves. Okay. This is the middle matzah. Some people would say, I'm inclined to do so, that this represents the body of Jesus, the second person. And we're going to take a cloth. It could be a tea towel shown in the picture, but that's a little bit crude. But here I got the middle matzah, and I'm going to fold it and put it away. What am I going to do with it? It's called something different now. It's called the afikomen. I'm just going to hide it. And traditional, in a traditional home, during the Seder service, this afikomen will be wrapped up and hidden away. What can we say about it? There's lots of things that we could say about it. In Luke's Gospel, it says in chapter 19, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace. But now it's hidden from your eyes. This country desperately needs peace, doesn't it? What will bring them peace at the moment? This part, half of the middle matzah, is wrapped and hidden away, only to be revealed at a later time. I think you can interpret what I'm saying. And of course, we know that as the sun was beginning to set, to usher in the special Sabbath, the 15th of Nisan, Joseph of Arimathea, of course, bought some linen cloth, took down the body, wrapped it in the linen, and placed it in a tomb cut out of rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. Now, as I say in the little note at the bottom, typically one of the adults around the table hides the wrapped half of the middle matzah so that children can search for it and find it later. But as my grandma's Haggadah pointed out, as I pointed it out to you, we get to a point where we start asking questions. It's called the four questions. Really strange to me, because I think there's only one question and four different answers. The question is this, and it's usually left to the youngest person present to tell us about this part of the Seder. The question is, why is this night different from all other nights? That's the question. We have four answers, and I think Aggie's going to tell us the answers.
Any other night, we may eat either leavened or unleavened bread. But on this night, only unleavened. Any other night, we may eat all kinds of herbs. But on this night, only bitter herbs. Any other night, we do not even dip once. But on this night, we dip twice. And any other night, we may sit either straight or reclining. But on this night, we all recline.
That's it. That's why this night is different. And then we move according to the traditional Haggadah, to the retelling of the story of the Israelites in Egypt. And we include this passage in Deuteronomy chapter 26 that Aggie will read to us.
My father was a wandering Aramean, and he went down into Egypt with a few people and lived there and became a great nation, powerful and numerous. But the Egyptians mistreated us and made us suffer, putting us to hard labor. Then we cried out to the Lord, the God of our fathers, and the Lord heard our voice and saw our misery, toil, and oppression. So the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with great terror and with miraculous signs and wonders.
Well, we put some more wine or grape juice into our cup because we're going to drink sooner or later, not for a while. The second cup. Now, what is the second cup? Well, it can have different names. It could be the cup of deliverance, which of course I have here, or it could be called the cup of freedom because it's based on that verse in Exodus chapter 6. I will free you from being slaves to them. Now, traditionally, what we do is we take a napkin and we take a drop of the wine or the grape juice that we've put into our glass for the second cup, and we take one drop at a time and we spill it on a napkin, and each drop represents one plague. We just do it one at a time, and we can actually, as we do it, we can dip our finger into the wine and we can drip it onto the napkin, and we can say one after the other the 10 plagues. So we start with blood, frogs, gnats, insects, pestilence, boils, hail, locusts, darkness, the slaying of the firstborn, the most dramatic and tragic of the plagues. Why are we not using these drops of wine or grape juice? Why are we doing this? It's so that we have a measure of sympathy for the Egyptians. In fact, Jesus said we should pray for our enemies, for those who persecute us. It's very challenging to do so. But that's why we take the time during the Seder to remove some of our wine and spill it on a napkin. And that leads us to the singing of a song, which is a very popular song. It's called Dayenu. Could be translated, "It is sufficient for us." I quite like that translation. Or "it is enough." It is enough for us, Einu, us. Now, in my booklet, page 14, I've actually got a way of doing it, but I found this on YouTube, and I thought I'd bring it to us. This is the singing of Dayenu, which is led by Jason Meshes.
Hey, everybody. Today, I want to talk about everybody's favorite song at the Seder. Dayenu, you know, the one that goes, Dayenu, Dayenu. Stop! What does it even mean? Okay, I'll tell you. It means it would have been enough. This song is all about all of these amazing things that God did for us. But even if God just did one of those things, it would have been enough. If God had just taken us out of Egypt, that would have been enough. If God had just given us the Torah, that would have been enough. If God had just given us Shabbat, that would have been enough. But God gave us all these things. Dayenu, we're so thankful. Oh my goodness, it's wonderful. It sounds like this. We'll start with the chorus. We just say, Dayenu. Dayenu. Die, die, ain't new. Sing it with me. Die, ain't new. Yeah, you got it. Die, ain't new. Ilu hotzi hotzianu hotzianu mi Mitzrayim hotzianu mi Mitzrayim. Die, ain't new. Sing it with me now. Die, ain't new. Die, ain't new. You got the hang of it. Die, ain't new. That sounds good. Die, ain't new. Let's sing it again. Die, ain't new. Okay. Die, ain't new. Natanu et hashabbat. Natanu et hashabbat. Die. All right, come on, guys. Sing it nice and loud. Die, ain't new. Die, ain't new. Yeah. Die, ain't new. One more time. Die, ain't new. Bum, ba ba da ba da. Oh, I didn't hear anyone. Bum, ba ba da ba da. Bum, bum. Nice job. Happy Passover, everybody.
Dainu. This is actually the image that we can see is Rick's seventh panel, the last thing that Jesus, Yeshua, said as he died. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. The fact is this, it is sufficient for us. Dainu. What does Paul say? My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Well, we haven't drunk from it yet. We've taken some drops out of it, it's true, but we're going to lift the cup, but we're not going to drink it, folks. But we can lift the cup because it gives me a fantastic opportunity to read from Grandma's Haggadah directly. I hope my eyes are good enough. This is highlighted where I'm reading. I love it. This is the words from this Haggadah. It therefore is incumbent on every Israelite in every generation to look upon himself as if he had actually gone forth from Egypt, as he said, and thou shalt declare unto thy son in that day, saying, This is done because of that which the Eternal did for me when I came forth from Egypt. Was not for our ancestors only that the Most Holy, blessed be He, redeemed from Egypt, but us also did He redeem with them, as He said, and He brought us out from thence that He might bring us in to give us the land which He sware unto our fathers. Taking the glass in hand, listen to these words, which are recited at every Orthodox Seder, most often in Hebrew, of course. We therefore are in duty bound to thank, praise, adore, glorify, extol, honor, bless, exalt, and reverence him who wrought all these miracles for our ancestors and for us. For he brought us forth from bondage to freedom, from sorrow to joy, from mourning unto holy days, from darkness to great light, and from servitude to redemption. And therefore let us chaunt unto him a new song. Hallelujah. Well, we've got to chaunt. That's a Victorian word, isn't it? A new song. What songs are we going to use? We put the cup down first, because we're not going to drink from it just yet. At the Seder. Some of the songs, not all of them, will be the Hallel Psalms that are from Psalm 113 to 118. They're used a lot, of course, these Hallel praise psalms, thanksgiving to God for his deliverance and blessings upon Israel. I found this beautiful version. It's one that I think we know quite well. Shows how old I am, doesn't it? 1976. But this is a beautiful version of this song that you know. Psalm, Hallel Psalm, is Psalm 114. I've longed to do this all my life, or all my believing life, which is over 50 odd years. In the early 80s, obviously living in England, I was very involved with Prayer for Israel, an organisation that continues to this day. And because I was so involved with Prayer for Israel in those days, around 1980 or so, 81, I got to know a singing group. They were called the Star of David Singers. They were established by Rachel Nelson, who became Rachel Bosky, who I know quite well even to this day. And they had a version of Psalm 114, which I've longed to use at a Seder. I had to find it. I had to convert it from a cassette tape into digital. The sound quality is not 100%, but you hear the beautiful voice of Patty, who was one of the Star of David Singers.
That you did flee, you Jordan, that you were driven back, you mountains that you skipped like rams, and you little hills like lambs tremble o'er at the presence of the the presence of the God of Jacob, who turned the rocky into standing waters, the flint into a fountain of
that was released in 1984, 40 years ago. Just shows how old I am, doesn't it? But here is something a little bit more modern, but actually again written by Rachel Nelson, who became Rachel Bosky, who live in Omagh, which is not very far from where we live. And it's sung for us now, we can join in if we like, by Barry and Batya Siegel.
Shabbat shalom.
Okay, now we can drink it. Lift the second cup. Remember, it's the cup of freedom. But we're reminded in John's Gospel that it says, if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagefen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. And we can recline and drink. Now, going through this quite quickly, it's at this point that we can eat various items. They're like appetizers for the main meal. The first one, matzi matzah. We can take a bit of the first matzah, the remaining half of the second matzah, and this can be sprinkled with salt, which is speaking of a covenant. This can be broken up and shared. And again, we have the specific blessing. If we've got that item, we can eat it as I say the blessing. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam ha-motzi lechem. Lechem is bread. Min ha-aretz. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth. Isn't that interesting? Brings forth bread from the earth, recognizing that Jesus is the bread from heaven. We can recline, have to recline because we're free men, and eat. And then the next thing that we would eat at the Seder is some of the bitter herbs. Remember, it's going to bring tears to our eyes. How are we going to eat it? Well, we can take some of the lettuce or the endive and add this mixture, haruset, to it. Now we're taking the leaf of the endive as something that's bitter in this particular instance, because it's easier to eat like that. They made their lives bitter with hard labour in brick and mortar and with all kinds of work in the fields. Aggie's going to read to us.
He has filled me with bitter herbs and sated me with gall. I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him.
Of course, that bitterness is also to be found at Calvary. They offered Jesus wine to drink. This is on another occasion, of course, probably towards the beginning. Mixed with gall, it was to deaden the pain and the suffering. But tasting it, he refused to drink it. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to eat bitter herbs. So if we have it, we can recline and eat. Now, in the traditional Seder, you have got this rather peculiar moment just before the meal when you have to make a sandwich. Now, this is very rabbinic. What has it got to do with Jesus? What does it say in the instructions? Everyone should take a piece of the third matzah together with other matzahs. Depends how much has been eaten so far, if necessary. and create a sandwich with bitter herbs. Now, this has got to include horseradish, in my opinion, because it's really got to be very bitter and difficult to eat. But you can make it a little bit sweeter with the haroset. What did Jesus eat at the Last Supper? We know he had 2 cups. We know he had unleavened bread. But there was another item. Susanna's going to read to us.
Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, "I tell you the truth, one of you is going to betray me." Leaning back against Jesus, he, John, asked him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered, "It is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish." Then, dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot.
Now, I think we can be absolutely sure that they were eating bitter herbs, because this was the Torah. This was what it says in the Torah: unleavened bread and bitter herbs. There's a dish. It's possible to dip bread into a dish. We can take this then, recline and eat. Now, what that leads to is a meal. Everybody breaks away from the order of service. This is a beautiful picture of an Orthodox Jewish family with young and old. Probably the little boy here on the bottom on the left is talking about the questions and answers. This is a traditional home. People will have a meal now. Could last for an hour. I mean, this is the point. This celebration of the Seder can take the whole evening, even into the early hours. We won't do that today, but it's not anything that you can do in a short time. We're moving on from the meal. And what the children will have been doing towards the end of the meal is searching for this aphikomen. It's hidden away. The children realize, if I can find it, I might get a reward. We need to pray for the young children or the young people in the land of Israel, because they're searching for answers. They're only to be found in the person of Yeshua, Jesus, who's hidden away. Jesus cried out, and this image, these images are taken from the Fountain of Tears. The one of the figure crying upwards is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Which is the fourth panel. And the little child on the inside of a crematorium door may be saying much the same. My God, why have you forsaken me? But according to Isaiah, this is our encouragement. I will wait for the Lord. Yes, at this time we have the aphikomen hidden, who's hiding his face from the house of Jacob. He's hiding his face from them. Inevitably, that has to lead to revelation. Now, we're moving a little bit away from a traditional Seder at this point, but there's a good reason for it. This is one of the Hallel Psalms, which we haven't referred to, but we can do it at this point. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be glory, because of your love and faithfulness. And then Jesus said these words. There's nothing hidden that will not be disclosed. And nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out into the open. Susanna will read.
then they will know that I am the Lord their God. For though I sent them into exile among the nations, I will gather them to their own land, not leaving any behind. I will no longer hide my face from them, for I will pour out my spirit on the house of Israel.
This is such a wonderful promise. It tells us lots of things. At this moment in time, his face, did we know that God has a face? Oh yeah, that's the face of Yeshua, Jesus. It's hidden. What's it going to take for him to no longer hide his face? It's the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which he promises to do throughout the Tanakh, but particularly here in Ezekiel. And of course it fits with what we read in Zechariah. Again, the Spirit. I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and supplication. They will look on me, the one they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only child, and grieve bitterly for him as one grieves for a firstborn son. I think these two passages are parallel. So we're after supper now, aren't we? We've had the supper. So we have maybe half of the second matzah that was hidden but is now revealed. And we can use it in an act of communion. Let's do that. If we've got that element with us, we could break it. This is what it says in Luke. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we are very grateful that we can participate in this celebration of the Passover, because you are the Passover Lamb. You are the Lamb of God, in fact, that takes away the sin of the world, and most particularly our sin. And as we look at this piece of unleavened bread, we're reminded that we are to take it and eat it in remembrance of you. And we are very grateful to do it, because we know that apart from you, we can do nothing. But through Christ, through the Messiah, we can do all things. And we bless you for our salvation. And we take this bread now. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam ha-motzi lechem min ha-aretz. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. And we will eat the bread together. We're going to put some more in our cup, because this is the cup after supper. It's based on this verse in Exodus chapter 6 verse 6, "I will redeem you with an outstretched arm." Don't you see Jesus in that verse? We see it so beautifully portrayed in Rick's second panel, actually, this one. "Today you'll be with me in paradise." You see, it says it in Luke. This is not the first cup, is it? In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Colin's going to read this for us.
And here we're reminded from the Apostle Peter, for you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect.
Amen. Well, we're taking a little journey before we drink the cup and before we thank the Lord for all that he has done for us, because there's another cup. Interesting, it says this in Mark's Gospel. When they had sung a hymn, what was the hymn? Yeah, it was one of the Hallel Psalms. They went out to the Mount of Olives. Jesus is very downcast, you see it in his face. This is Rick's piece, which is called Gethsemane. You will all fall away, Jesus told them, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. This is actually taken from Zechariah chapter 13. We could talk about it, it's okay. Colin's going to read this to us.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, he said to them. Stay here and keep watch. Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will.
Jesus knew what it was going to cost him. That's why he's struggling with the cup in his hand. And this is what it says in the Hallel Psalm, which we haven't referred to just yet, Psalm 116. How can I repay the Lord? How can I repay the Lord for all his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. I believe these are the words that were in Jesus' mind. This was probably the hymn that was sung. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, truly, I am your servant. I am your servant, the son of your maidservant. You freed me from my chains. I will sacrifice a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst. O Jerusalem, praise the Lord. Father, as we hold this cup, the cup of redemption, the cup of salvation, we recognize that we can only do one thing, to repay the Lord for all his goodness to us, and that's to give our lives to you in worship and adoration, in service. Lord, we know that we're sinners, but we also recognize that if we confess our sin, you're faithful and just and will forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And we thank you that the agent of our cleansing is the blood of Jesus. So we take this cup after supper, the cup of redemption, and say thank you. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. Borei pri hagefen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. And we can drink this cup. now. We've got a fourth cup.
Okay.
And we've still got time. We won't go over time, I hope. I don't think we will. We could call this by lots of different names. The cup of praise seems to be a good one. We should finish the Seder in praise. And we look forward, too, to the prophetic, where God says, still, I will take you as my own people. But there's another element to this Seder that I want to emphasize that is not often done, even in a Messianic Seder. Why should we be in praise? It's because the Lord is risen. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. You see, Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. Then he says this, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. That's an interesting word to use. The reason for that is that almost certainly within the Feast of Unleavened Bread, there's another festival. It's called First Fruits. It's also a feast of the Lord. This is what it says in Leviticus 23, which lists seven feasts of the Lord, of course, Passover being one. When you come into the land which I give to you and reap its harvest, then you shall bring a sheaf. This is technically also the first day of the Omer counting, the 50 days. A sheaf of the first fruits of your harvest to the priest. He will lift it and raise it and wave the sheaf before the Lord to be accepted on your behalf on the day after the Sabbath. This was a problem for the Jewish people. What Sabbath was the Lord saying in Leviticus 23? There were differences of opinion. We could talk about that for hours. But we know the answer to that, don't we? Don't we? After the Sabbath, this would be the weekly Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. So Jesus fulfills it all. They're the feast of the Lord. They're the feast of Jesus. So even his raising, being raised from the dead, is written within the Torah. Why? Paul helps us. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive, but each in his own turn. Christ, the first fruits, then when he comes, those who belong to him, there's resurrection of the dead. This bronze figure is actually at the base of the final panel, the seventh panel, into your hands I commend my spirit. It's as though the living and the dead are buried together. But in Ezekiel chapter 37 it says, O my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. We're living in those days. At this point, towards the end of our Seder, we need to fill a fifth cup, actually, after all that. It's filled to overflowing, actually, but it's not one we're going to drink from, because it's being prepared for the prophet Elijah. Jewish people, we could do it ourselves now. We can go to the door, we could open the door, and see if there's somebody waiting to come in. What do we know? This is what it says in Malachi. See, I will send you the prophet Elijah before that great and dreadful day of the Lord comes. This is a little piece which we call the butterfly at the fountain of tears. The hand of the child is going through the crematorium door and it's clutching the ground which represents the nation of Israel. Because this is the next verse in Exodus chapter 6. That's interesting. It's another I will. We can apply it to the cup of Elijah. I will bring you to the land I swore with uplifted hand to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And Roger's going to read to us.
From Ezekiel 36. For I will take you out of the nation. I will gather you from all the countries and bring you back to your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. You will live in the land I gave your forefathers. You will be my people, and I will be your God.
Now, Aggie will read to us.
The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up to David a righteous branch, a king who will reign wisely and do what is just and right in the land. In his day, Judah will be saved and Israel will live in safety. This is the name by which he will be called, the Lord our righteousness. So then, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when people will no longer say, as surely as the Lord lives who brought the Israelites up out of Egypt, but they will say, as surely as the Lord lives who brought the descendants of Israel up out of the land of the north and out of all the countries where he had banished them, then they will live in their own land.
It's not a Hallel psalm, it's a psalm of ascent. It's all about Aliyah. It's interesting words for us. When the Lord brought back the captives to Zion, and then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. It goes on. I like this, because I live on the edge of the Negev. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like streams in the Negev. Those who sow in tears, many tears in these days, will reap with songs of joy. And Aggie will continue to read to us.
I will not die, but live, and will proclaim what the Lord has done. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. O Lord, save us. O Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
This is the last Hallel psalm. Actually, the whole psalm itself is speaking of, I think, the future conflict, when in fact the Lord himself will return. The nation of Israel will be prepared for that day. because this is what Jesus said. You will not see me again until you say, according to Psalm 118, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We can sing a fantastic song.
Take off your dust and fix your eyes on me.
to conclude very nearly this Seder, I want to turn again to my grandma's Haggadah. I'm sure she didn't realise in the 19th century we would be using it today. This is how it concludes. I just want to use the words that are here that would have been repeated by my grandma and so many Orthodox, particularly in England. And in the congregation of many thousands of thy people, the house of Israel, shall thy name, O our King, be glorified in song throughout all generations. For such is the duty of every created being towards thee, O Lord, our God, and the God of our fathers, to render thanks, to praise, extol, glorify, exalt, ascribe glory, bless and magnify and adore thee with all the songs and praises of thy servant David, the son of Jesse, thine anointed. Thy name shall be praised forever. Almighty, great and holy King, in heaven and earth, for unto thee, O Lord our God, and the God of our fathers, appertaineth song and praise, hymn and psalm, strength and dominion, victory, power and greatness, adoration and glory, holiness and majesty, blessings and thanksgivings from now and forevermore. Blessed art thou, O Lord, almighty King, glorified with praises, most worthy of thanksgivings, Lord of miracles, who delighted in the songs of psalmody, King, almighty and eternal. So we raise the fourth cup, the last cup. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, Borei Pri HaGefen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. And we recline and drink the cup of praise. Jeremy's going to read.
Revelation, worthy is the Lamb. Then I saw a Lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing in the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. He had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He came and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding a golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased men for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth." Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands, and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they sang, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them singing, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever."
And Colin reads to us.
Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Amen.
And this is, in the background, we see Rick's sixth panel, actually. This is when Jesus cries out, "It is finished." This also means it is complete. And for this, we look forward into the days ahead. This is what the Lord says. This is our expectation, our hope. "I will return to Zion and dwell in Jerusalem. Then Jerusalem will be called the City of Truth, and the mountain of the Lord Almighty will be called the Holy Mountain." And in Joel, "Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be deliverance, as the Lord has said, among the survivors whom the Lord calls." And Jesus said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." Will it be this year? Will it be? I'm not sure. But one thing we can hope, and we can all say together, as indeed is said at the conclusion of every Seder, next year in Jerusalem.
From getting through. Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
Is all creation groaning? Is a new worthy of all blessing and honor and glory. Is he worthy of